So, well, welcome everyone. So, I hope you enjoy today because we have the great Deepanka Das, who is always here asking questions.
This is
and today, it's our chance to ask questions to him. So, get ready for many questions, Deepanka.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. So, as I said last week, that I will be talking about something pretty basic. I should first warn you what I am going to tell so that you do not waste your time here, because there will be nothing new probably at the end. So I will be my object is to revisit standard model from some unorthodox, maybe not so popular viewpoint. That's the unitarity viewpoint. Now I assume why I am daring to present such a thing, because I assume this is a pedestrian seminar, so I should present myself as a pedestrian, talking to a group of pedestrians, talking about a thing that a pedestrian should care about. So, I think this will be a good way to start. So, now we know that the standard model explains many things, and standard model is beautiful, but to me, when I first learned standard model from a gauge theoretic point of view, it's like you start, like it's like magic. You start with SU2 plus U1 gauge theory. Okay, you understand that you need a massive vector bosons, because Fermi theory is an effective field theory. You need to go beyond that. Then you need charged gauge bosons. Then you think about non-abelian gauge symmetry. You break that down, and some beautiful things arise. And then you associate it. Then you associate the gauge theory with spontaneous symmetry breaking. Now, what is the difference between spontaneous symmetry breaking and hard symmetry breaking by hand? If you break the symmetry by hand, then all your couplings are unrelated. Like the coupling of HQ and H to the power 4 are not related. If you can put arbitrary coefficient there, right? If there is no symmetry and you have a scalar field, then you can write something A times HQ plus B times H to the power 4. But when you have spontaneous symmetry breaking, you have a relation between them. They are not arbitrary. So these are the beautiful things, that the couplings are related in a very particular way, and we have tasted those things. Now, what I am going to tell you here is that without appealing to the non-abelian part of the gauge theory, only assuming QED and seeing what experiments throws us into, can we re-derive those relations? Like in the exact way, suppose the jet boson coupling to the neutrinos, how it will be related to the gauge couplings. I will not be talking about the gauge couplings anyway. So that's my motivation here, not to talk about SU2 gauge theory, not to talk about Young-Mills theory, but to derive standard model. So that's the project. Okay. So the principle I will be talking about is called the principle of unitarity. And I will prove how by systematic requirement that unitarity should be satisfied at any level, you can derive all the good properties of the standard model. Okay, so let's start. So here you express any Feynman amplitude, since the Feynman amplitude will be a function of scattering angle. So to start with, you take any 2 plus 2 scattering. And since it will be a complete function of the scattering angle theta, you can expand it in terms of a Legendre polynomial. Okay, this is very general, and you can write it anywhere. But when you impose the condition that the S matrix will be unitary, you can restrict that each and every partial wave amplitude there will be less than or equals to 1. Okay. If this is true, then suppose if you believe in perturbative calculation, then this relation should be obeyed order by order. You can look at this paper if you are interested. If you believe in perturbative calculation, then you calculate the Feynman amplitude. This thing will hold in the tree level also. Okay, now surely if this tree level amplitude grows with energy, suppose you have a term which grows with center of moment of energy, and presumably some of the partial wave amplitude will contain an energy factor. So what you can say is that if you increase the energy to an arbitrary level, then at some point this relation will not hold true. Okay? So whatever theory you are considering, if the amplitude grows with energy, that theory is not ultraviolet safe. I mean, there must be a cutoff. So that's not a good theory to arbitrary energies. So what I will require is that this should not happen. There should not be any term in my Feynman amplitude that should grow with energy. That's the simple principle. That's my hypothesis to start with. Now, is this a rule? We'll see it later. Okay. So now let's start with Fermi theory. Okay. So this is the simple and simplest case. So Fermi theory is the current-current interaction with lepton-lepton current. For example, suppose you consider this scattering, say new electron going to new electron scattering here. Say new electron going to new electron. You can write it as a Fermi vertex here. You consider the scattering, and when you write the Feynman amplitude, it should be dimensionless. Okay, so GF is of mass dimension minus 2 from that theory, and then it should grow with E square. Okay, so this is problematic, as I said. So if the Feynman amplitude grows with E square, then you will have trouble. So this is not my complete theory. Okay, everybody knows that. Then what should we do? So the first lesson we learned is that any coupling should not have any mass dimension. Not have negative mass dimension. So then the only way is that I see that my J mu has mass dimension plus 3 and it carries a Lorentz index. So if I break the Fermi theory up into a propagator, I must introduce a particle which has a Lorentz index and which has mass dimension 1 and which is charged, because Fermi theory is basically transform neutrino into electron, so it must have a charge. Okay, so I introduced an intermediate vector boson. Okay, I am not saying that this vector boson, it has a spin 1 because it carries a Lorentz index, but I am not saying that this is necessarily is a gauge boson. So don't associate with this intermediate vector boson any gauge property. So I introduce this. So this is my first level of theory. Okay, in the interaction, I introduce a gauge boson there. So my coupling is now free of mass dimension. So that problem is gone at the three level. That doesn't grow anymore. So now this W plus minus must have a non-zero mass so that it weak interaction becomes short range. Now if you compute the low energy muon decay with this Lagrangian and the Fermi Lagrangian, compare the low energy limits, you will get this relation, because according to this theory it will depend on G squared over MW squared, and according to Fermi theory it depends on GF. So if the two theories are equivalent at low energy, then GF should be written as this. Okay, so fine. Of course, because W is a spin 1 vector boson, we should write the following quantum field theory. It's propagated as this. Okay. As a result of introducing W boson, you have no divergences, energy growth in these processes. But now I want to answer the question, how should I write the U1, the electromagnetic part of this W plus minus boson? Okay. So for this, I see that I assume that this W phase transform under electromagnetism like this, as this. This is the electromagnetic gauge symmetry. Okay, it has nothing to do with the SU21. And if this is the my transformation, then the interaction, the minimal interaction should be this. So this is basically F mu nu dagger for W boson and the mass term, right? Now, do not think that these mass terms violate any gauge symmetry. I'm not talking about SU2 gauge symmetry. I'm not saying that W boson is a gauge boson. Okay, it's a spin 1 boson which carries an electromagnetic charge. So this term actually does not violate this gauge symmetry. So I can write that term. This minimal Lagrangian will give me the equation of motion for the W's. Now, if you notice carefully, there is one more term that I can write here, because this is invariant and f mu nu is invariant under U1 gauge symmetry. But this minimal interaction does not give me this term. Okay? So I introduce this term with an arbitrary factor kappa here. I do not say anything kappa a priori. I do not know. Let's have an open mind. Let's include this term, like my Lagrangian will be L min plus L prime, and we will keep an open mind. We will see what value of kappa we need to have good high energy behavior so that my scattering processes do not contain any energy growth. Okay, so this is my total W boson Lagrangian, LW plus L prime. Now, what you do is that, you consider this W plus W minus going to photon photon. Let me find, where do I have this? And if you look before, this term actually gives you W, W and one photon, single photon here, and the other is derivative. So, if you consider this diagram, like say W, W to gamma, gamma, and you can have this type of things here, say W here, photon here, W here, gamma here, right? And plus, you will have W, W, gamma, gamma, because you will have also this kind of interactions here. So, now these vertices, they depend on kappa, okay? And this does not. This is just the electromagnetic charge. This is this E square, okay? Now, if you calculate the leading energy growth, suppose you have you consider the longitudinal polarization. Suppose this W is WL, then longitudinal polarization is basically the momentum. Okay? Epsilon L is basically the momentum. So you have a factor of momentum here. You have a factor of momentum here. And these vertices are derivative couplings. So in the Feynman rules, you will have momentum here, you will have momentum here. Okay? You have four momentums, P, 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 and you will have, in the propagator, you will have 1 by E square. Okay? So, in the leading order, it will grow as P to the power 4 by E square. Okay? That is E square. This one will grow as E square. Okay? So, you will have trouble. And you see, that this one also goes as E square. You have P here, you have P here. It's E square. Now, this person should cancel this person. This one depends on kappa, this one does not. Okay? So, for a particular value of kappa, you can cancel these two growth. And that value of kappa, you will see that this growth will be proportional to 1 minus kappa whole square. Okay? So, unless you choose kappa equals to 1, you will not have a good theory. So, you have to choose kappa equals to 1. So, you have introduced this coupling without any bias, let it there be, and you see that it plays an interesting role, and you have to choose kappa equals to 1. Now, you see, if you include this term up here with kappa equals to 1, you exactly get the Young-Mills structure of the WW photon vertex, okay? So, this is the next thing. So you see, without demanding non-abelian gauge theory, just by demanding cancellation of your energy growths, you can get the exact Young-Mills structure with WW photon photon vertex. Now, this is up there. Now, what about the other properties? Now, I have not introduced the Jet boson yet. Okay. Now, I am going to do. How? Because of this. Now, consider this scattering. E minus, E plus to W minus, W plus. Okay. Let me show what happens here by the Feynman diagram. So, suppose E minus, E plus, then to W plus, W minus. So, you have E, you have neutrino here, you have electron here, and you have WL here. WL here and plus you can have photon see after what we have learned these only these two diagrams exist because I have no Z boson yet okay now watch carefully let's kind of try to figure out what is the leading energy goal if these are longitudinal polarization then in the polarization vector of these guys, you will have momentum, here you will have momentum, okay? And what else? In the fermionic vortex, here you will have 1 by energy, because this is the fermionic coupling, because this is the fermionic propagator. And in here, you will have one U spinner, you will have a V spinner, okay? Now these spinners has square root of E in their normalization. Remember, like U bar U is 2E, something like that. So each one of them grows as square root of E. Okay. So now you collect everything. So energy, one energy. Three energy up, one energy down. So it grows as order E square. Okay. Now, look at here. You have U spinner here, U spinner here. You have momentum here, momentum here. You have another factor of momentum in this vertex because this is the derivative vertex. Three gauge bosons, three Lorentz indices. And you have 1 by E square in the propagator. So 1, 2, 3, 4 up, 2 down. Here you also have E square growth. Okay. Now you will be tempting. Let's cancel this one with this one, but you have to be careful. This vertex is only left-handed. This is V minus A, but this is V plus A. Okay, so this one will not contain any gamma phi, and this one will do. So you cannot cancel this with this one, and explicitly you can see it here. This is your the neutrino contribution. It has a 1 minus gamma phi here. And this is the photon contribution over there. So you see, you have V2 bar. So this is square root of E. This is square root of E. This is energy. And this is momentum. This is E square. Okay? That is also E square. But here there is an extra term, V2 bar, gamma phi U1, which is not there. So you cannot cancel that. So now, so you have to cancel this one. So you have to introduce new things. Okay? Now what new thing can you introduce? First option, let's start with minimal thing. Let's introduce a new scalar. Okay. So if you try to introduce a new scalar, you are actually introducing a diagram like this, right? Now count its the degree of divergence. Okay. So here it's again square root of E. This is dimensionless, this is dimensionless, and E here, and 1 by E square here. So you see 1, 2, 3 E upstairs, 2 E downstairs. So at the leading order, it grows as E, not E square. But this diagram will not help. So a scalar will not save you. Okay? So go to the next minimal version. Okay? So next thing you can do, the scalar doesn't work. So let's introduce another fermion, say, something like this, spin 0 plus spin half. So I introduce another heavy fermion, say, I call it E0, say one heavy neutrino, okay? And I introduce this diagram, W, W. And I assume that E0 contains left-handed as well as right-handed coupling with different strengths so that I can have a gamma 5 here, okay? Now, if I, this E0, if the coupling strengths are GL and GR, then by demanding this cancellation, the E square growth cancellation, you will have a relation something like this. What is it? So if you demand the cancellation, you will have GL squared equals to E square minus G square over 2. This is by demanding your cancellation. By the way, this was actually a model. I think this goes by the name of Georgi-Glasow model that were popular in the 70s when W. Wilson was not been seen. And why it was killed, it is very obvious. Now I will say that. So if this is the condition of your energy growth cancellation, then you can easily see this is positive and this gives you so G square is less than 2 E square. Okay. Now if G square is less than 2 E square and you have a relation that your Fermi constant is equals to G square over 4 root 2 MW square. Remember you got that from equivalent muon decay. Now if G square is less than something, then MW should be less than something so that you have a experimental value of GF, right? And that less than something is, you can calculate basically from this and this. And then MW will come out to be less than 53 GeV. Okay, so this was an option. You introduce it, you get this relation, and this tells you the W version you are introducing must be less than 53 GeV. After you see the W version, this option is ruled out. Okay, so two options gone. So the next option, which is our favorite option, is to introduce another spin 1 boson. Something L, like this, and you cancel, okay? And there is not a problem like that. Now, I'll show what happens. So, another particle needed, and then you introduce spin 0, doesn't help. Spin half, it doesn't help. Then you introduce a Z boson. Okay. Before going into further details of how this Z boson should interact with E and other fermions, let us first try to figure out how the Z boson will interact with W. Okay. This is very easy to do. So the trilinear WWZ coupling will carry three Lorentz indices. So you write the most general thing that you can write with WWZ and you demand cancellation. Cancellation in the process is like here. Okay. I'll come back to this. Now, EE to WW, this is one, this is number one, then you have E nu W plus to WJ, number two, and I have the detail here, but the detail is boring. I will just show you. This is nu E plus to W plus J. Okay. Now this vertex is unknown in all of this case. So this is a general, if you like, T alpha mu nu. This is a general thing, and you have written the most general things in this thing. Now what will happen is that the leading growth will come from the Q mu Q nu term of this propagator. Okay, so if you write this propagator, it will be something like G mu nu minus Q mu Q nu by mz square divided by s minus mz square. Okay. Now, you have square root of E here, square root of E here, you have P here, E here, and E here. So, when you pick up this term, you see there is no suppression from the propagator. See, because Q mu, Q nu cancel with S. Okay, that's gone. So, the leading order growth is pretty violent. Is E square here, E here, E cube, e to the power 4. That will not be cancelled by anybody if there is a vector Bosonpropagator. So it has to cancel by itself. Okay? And when you demand that cancellation, you will get relation between this coefficient of different Lorentz structures. Okay? So you demand the cancellation here, same cancellation here, and same cancellation here. What you end up with, the WWZ vertex will be an arbitrary coefficient multiplied by the Young structure. In the same way we got the WW gamma vertex, here you will get the same but with some more work. So again, Young-Mills structure arises just by demanding cancellation of your energy growth. Okay, let's now, but we have not determined what this is. Now let's proceed to see what this electron-electron Z vertex is. I keep it general, I say that this is the GL, GR, Z mean, and since neutrino is left-handed, for mu Z, I have only one coupling. Okay, so I have four couplings to determine. Okay, now then what you consider, you consider four processes. So you can consider consider the same thing, E plus E minus going to W plus W minus. Now here there will be two pieces, one proportional to one with gamma 5, one without gamma 5. You demand both to be 0 and you get two equations. The equations will look like minus G square over 2 plus E square minus GL GWWZ equals 0. So determine, and another thing is that E square minus GF GWWJ equals 0. Here 2. Okay. Then you consider neutrino and neutrino to W plus W minus. Here since this is only left-handed, so you will have one condition. Okay. So the condition here is minus G square over 2 plus G nu nu J GWWZ equals to 0. And then you consider E plus nu to ZW minus. Okay? Since again this is left-handed current, you will have one condition. And the condition is minus GL plus G nu nu Z minus GWWZ equals 0. So you have four conditions. From four processes, you get the leading order, you demand the leading order cancellation of these processes, and you get these conditions. Now, you see there are six parameters in these four equations. Okay, so GL, GR, GWWZ, G nu nu Z, E, and G. And you have four relations. So you can trade four of them in terms of the other two. For convenience, I choose G and E because I want to match at the end with the standard model. So I assume that G and E are independent, and I try to find a solution for the other four. Now, one interesting thing is that if you pick GL from here, okay, and then substitute GL over there, then one will be GWWZ square, another will be G nu nu Z times GWWZ. Okay? Now you replace G nu nu Z, GWWZ from here as half Z square. So here
you only have G W W Z square and G square and E square. So you can get what G W W Z square is. So if you do that, you will get G W W Z square is basically G square minus E square. This minus sign is important. And this one is real and positive. You see G is greater than E here for the first time. Okay? So you just solve it and you will get this. Now I reparameterize things. Since G is greater than E, I can define a sine angle. Yeah, I call it sine theta W. I'm not calling it yet Weinberg angle, which is E by G. Because E less than G, I can define that angle. Okay? So now my independent parameter, if you like, are G and sin theta W, and I can express everything in terms of that. And voila. Okay? The exact same couplings that you get in the standard model. Okay? There is no ambiguity, overall sine ambiguity of course, but that's due to the definition of the field. So this is the exact standard model couplings that you get. I have not told you anything about the origin of this theta W. I'm not saying this is the mixing angle between the photon and the jet or anything else. It's just an artificial angle that I created because of this, which I can always create, and to make our life simple. And these are the couplings. Okay. But there is more, actually. If you remember this E plus E minus into W plus W minus diagram, so there was fermionic diagrams and Gauge boson diagrams. So it looked something like this. E minus E plus here and W here. So in the leading order it grew as E square, this one. And then in the next to leading order it will grow as energy, because you can keep expanding this propagator and keep one factor of energy out at the end. What happens if you look at this, this energy growth, and if you want this to be zero, you end up with a with something. So the condition here reads, you take a different color because this is very important, muy importante. For this to be zero, the condition you need is quite amazing. Gr minus G nu nu z plus G W W Z 1 minus M Z square divided by 2 M W square equals to 0. This masses comes from because you are expanding about the propagator. Okay? So you demand this to be 0, you get this condition. Now you substitute your solutions, things that you know here. You know GR, G nu nu Z, G W W Z. You substitute here. And the relation you get is MW equals to MJ cos theta W. Looks familiar? So I didn't talk about spontaneous symmetry breaking, I didn't talk about custodial symmetry. You get the exact same relation just by demanding that my amplitude should not have energy growth. Now, this is a very powerful relation. How? This actually constitutes one of the best tests of the standard model. To me, actually, one might differ. When you combine this relation with, what did I write? With the GF relation. GF equals to G square over 4 root 2 MW square. Okay? So you combine these two relations and you can predict MW and MJ in terms of theta W and GF. The prediction goes like MW equals to pi alpha divided by GF root 2 to the power half 1 by sine theta W, and MJ equals to blah 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 extra cos theta W, this one by cos theta W, right? So it means you measure sine theta W and cosine theta W, you know MW over MJ. How do you know if sin theta W and cos theta W exist? You look for this scattering. I think it was muon, neutrino and electron. Okay. I think this is So muon neutrino electron going to muon neutrino electron. Okay, this will be only mediated by Z boson. So this vortex will only be sensitive to sin square theta W, nothing else. Okay, the only unknown thing here is sin square theta W. So if you see this scattering and if you measure it, you have an unambiguous determination of sin square theta W. So the previous measurement was like sin square theta W was like 0.22 or something like that in that ballpark. You substitute it here, you get your prediction here 79 GeV. And this is 90 GeV, very robust. So actually the model tells you not what to look for, but where to look for. Okay, so you have laid out all the ingredients and so you know where your masses should be, new particles. Fine, so we have now W, Z, everything in the standard model gauge sector. We derived every couplings that apparently SU2 gauge symmetry would give us, but from a different way of approaching, and apparently we are in the correct direction. Now let's motivate the Higgs. Okay, what is the Higgs? Higgs comes in the next stage. Okay, so we are talking about the leading order divergence cancellation, the leading order energy growth cancellation. Oh, it's warm for me also. When we talk about next to leading order energy growth cancellation, there we have to introduce the Higgs. Oh, I forgot one thing. When to introduce the self interaction, the quarting interaction between the gauge bosons. Let's make a small thing about that one. So, okay. Okay, now we consider this, I think the most famous scattering, this one. Okay, so you have p-channel diagrams, I call all of them minus. You have t and u-channel diagrams, and you add these things up and you see that the leading order growth do not cancel. Then you add this thing, and with the exact standard model coupling and the leading order, in this case it will be to the power 4, this will cancel. Okay, I want to go quick through this stage because I want to comment something about BSM, but I think I made my point. Standard model is a good theory from unitarity viewpoint. Next thing you want to do is that you want to look at the E square growth in this thing. So these three diagrams cancel it to the power 4. The next is E square. That it doesn't cancel. Okay, then you start with the minimal things. Okay, spin zero. You introduce H. This one everybody knows. This is very famous. You make this coupling arbitrary. GWWH arbitrary. Okay, and demand GWWH should be such that it cancels the energy growth from here. Okay, and your GWWH will come to be GMW. Okay, now when you have GWWH, continue the same game with E plus E minus to WW. Okay, so here you will have EEHWW. Your demand, my growth cancels, the next to leading order growth cancels. Here you know GWWH, GEEH is unknown, get that. And here you will find that GEEH is basically minus GME over MW. I don't know if there is a factor there. So Higgs is something that couples proportional to the mass, just not by accident, just because of the this kind of cancellations. Okay. Next, the GZZH, you consider EE to same boarding game, ZZ. Here you will have GHHZZ, you know GEEH now, so demand that and you get GHZZ. Okay, so anyway, you can get every coupling of the standard model using this principle and you can rebuild from a bottom up way. Okay, so that's the standard model part.
I want to hear about questions now, before I move on. Yes, please.
You said you measured the muon neutrino electron at Kadir.
Yes, muon neutrino to electron, yeah.
How do you do that?
That's a good question. Because, I don't know, so you tag the muon just by the end product, you are seeing muon, so you know that the muon neutrino is produced, okay? And we have to check the experimental fact here. Okay, I will check.
So my question is, how will you measure that before finding a set position?
Why not? I mean, this diagram exists, right? You will have a low energy process.
But I think in history it wasn't this way.
I know.
It wasn't all the way. He's just proposing.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the cleanest way of measuring sin square theta w because there is no jet boson mass. Even if there is the jet boson mass involved, you can replace it with, you know, g square over mz square. You can replace it by gf.
But I mean, it's hard to make a prediction for the masses instead of something that is hard to measure.
No, I do not have to make a prediction of the mass to get sin square theta w.
Right.
Okay. I do not have to I can measure sin square theta w before measuring masses. There is because you know this neutrino, this nu mu, this going to say electron. So this will have this, they have gauge couplings here, so you have g square and below you have mz square. Okay? You replace mz square as mw over cw square. And g square over mw square is gf. So you know everything except theta w. Okay, so you can extract theta w from there and then make a prediction of the jet mass. Okay, so that's a Gedanken way of doing things. Okay. So, anyway, any other standard model part? I'll not talk about these things anymore. Okay. You need quarks, but fine. So this one I want to talk about the first way, the first step to go beyond the standard model. Do I need necessarily a scalar to cancel those energy growths, like those residual things here? So, you know, I want to talk about this because when I started my PhD, I was doing these kind of things. And the interesting thing is that you can generate this extra dimensional spectrum just by demanding energy growth cancellation. So, suppose you think about this WW to WW, but cancellation of the next two leading order energy growth, E square. Say, you do not want the Higgs. You want to go next higher possibility. You cannot have fermions, okay? Nothing. So you have to go beyond, you have to introduce something, say, Z prime, okay? Now, with the Z prime, you can cancel this E square, that's great. But you have to obey something, relation like this GWW, this quartic coupling will be sum of all the neutral boson coupling square. Okay, so that means you have to take some coupling, some trilinear coupling from the Z and feed it into Z prime so that that relation is satisfied. So what you are saying is that your GWWZ coupling is reduced slightly, and that coupling is fed into Z prime to make that growth happen. And then with that, you cancel E square. But there is a consequence. Then after that, canceling this with Z prime, when you look at this, W minus Z going to W minus Z, okay? At first you had only these diagrams, so W, Z, one is of course W, Z, WWZ.
You only have something like this, okay? And since now this coupling you have reduced, because to introduce a Z prime, this coupling is not the standard model like coupling, you have reduced it. So this process will not be unitary. So to survive, you have to add another diagram. Say you will have WZ here, WZ here. You have to introduce another new W prime. So that now this one with reduced coupling adds up with this one to make your theory unitary. But that's not all again. When you have introduced W prime here, you can now consider W prime minus going to W prime minus. Then you will find only Z and Z prime will not unitarize this. You need another Z double prime. When you have Z double prime, you can go back here with W replaced by W prime, and you will need a W double prime. You go on, you build up the whole KK tower. Okay? And the KK tower should obey this sum rule. And these intelligent people have shown that if you start with a UED theory with Dirichlet and Neumann boundary condition, you have exactly these things satisfied. So this is one example where you do not unitarize WW scattering by Higgs, but by Z boson, but you need infinite number of them. So just by demanding unitary cancellation, you are late to the KK tower. Now, this was my first lesson during my PhD, okay? So, a little history will be important. I started my PhD in 2010. Indian regulation requires that you waste your first year of your PhD doing some coursework. Okay? That might be something useful. You do no research, just do and pass exam. You have to pass exam to qualify for a PhD. So it took me 2011 to start for a PhD. And when I started, I went to my supervisor, what should I do? And my supervisor believed that Higgs will never be found at that time. And he told me, do something with models that did not require a Higgs. And by 2012, April, I came up with this. So I read the paper by Sawasaki that I mentioned here. And I thought, if I can extend that work to fermionic sector, can I build up the KK fermions? In the five-dimensional Dirac fermions from Dirichlet and Neumann boundary condition. And I found that the general sum rule will be this, and I could derive that in the minimal universal extra dimension, where you have no Higgs, you can actually satisfy these things just by boundary conditions. And I was very excited in April. I told my supervisor I have got this. Supervisor said, okay, it's very nice. Yeah, it's a new thing, we can write something up. And writing, it took up to July 11th, and the July 4th, the disaster came, and my supervisor said, okay, fine, you have did a nice thing, but it's not worth it, okay? So that was my first lesson in a PhD. I wasted 1 year using Higgs-less models. But only recently, I learned you can do more using unitarity. This I realized I don't know, this idea is just a few weeks old, which I'm going to tell you, which is sadly not new. After I did this, I found that people know this. Of course, they know. They're smarter. And this is to motivate seesaw from unitarity. Believe it or not, it can be done. Okay. So, okay, so here what you assume is that the neutrino has a 3-level Majorana mass. Okay, so what the point I'm trying to make, if you assume 3-level Majorana mass for neutrinos, then you need something like seesaw to make it good, like in a good way. Why? Because if the neutrinos has 3-level Majorana mass, Where is the diagram? Here. Then you can consider E minus E minus to WL minus WL minus this process. This is lepton flavor violating, lepton number violating, and it can happen if neutrino has Majorana mass. So you can consider this one, for example, E minus. Here new Y coming. Here you also annihilate an E minus. Here is a new Y coming. They can flip because Majorana. Okay. So here you have WL minus. Again, to count the dimension. So here you have square root of E, the same game, square root of E, and here you have energy, here you have 1 by energy. So you will see it will grow as 1, 2, 3 by 1, so as E square. But actually it will not grow as E square because you can trade one energy for Dirac equation. Just not worry about the detail. The main thing is that it will grow with energy. And if you just say that I have only neutrino, only Majorana neutrinos and nothing else, then this theory is not unitary up to high energies because it grows with energy. Okay? So you have to add to it something that will cancel its energy growth. Okay? What you can do? So just imagine these vertices. These vertices are nothing but PM-minus element. And since this require a mass flip, this will be proportional to the Majorana mass of the neutrinos. Right? If the Majorana mass is zero, then this diagram is zero. So this must be proportional to Majorana neutrino mass. And that's why it compensates one order of energy. Okay, so the one order of energy goes into the Majorana mass and the whole thing grows as energy. So something like this. Some PM-minus element square, m nu, energy. Now, you can now say that, okay, this cannot be valid up to arbitrary energies. So to how much energy it can be valid? When this thing is less than 1. So that will give you a bound on the energy. You calculate that bound with all the factor, and the bound comes out to be 10 to the power 14 GeV, which is the gut scale. Okay, so you're just by computing, you assume that the neutrino has Majorana mass, you compute the energy growth here, you use your unitarity principle, and you see that there will be some new physics below the gut scale. Now, what kind of new physics do you demand? You have to cancel this. One thing you can do, a similar diagram like with another heavy fermion. Say here you say NR or E0 to cancel this. That is your famous type 1 or type 3 seesaw. Okay? And when you demand this diagram cancels with this diagram, you get exactly the type 1 and type 3 seesaw relation. You can do another thing actually. You can say that you have a doubly charged scalar, E minus E minus going to H plus plus and then H minus minus W minus W minus. Okay? So this is proportional to the Yukawa in the type 2 seesaw. Okay? So you can demand that this diagram actually cancels with this diagram. You will get type 2 seesaw. Okay? You know, in the type 2 seesaw, this YE, exact type 2 seesaw relation you will get if you demand this diagram to cancel with this diagram. Okay, so, my goal was to say that unitarity is not just a mere principle. You can use it to build up models to have correct coupling prediction, etc., etc. So, I will end with a single line, this. With unitarity, you say, what is impossible, and then you go to the possible alternatives of the theory. Okay, so now fire away.
Well, first of all, thank you. Very nice talk. Time for questions, discussion. I have questions about history. So I have investigated how people thought about this question before the standard model was actually built.
See, the Fermi theory was known that it's not good, but the first building, like rebuilding of standard model, came I think in 1970, after like 6 or 7 years after the model was actually proposed by S. D. Joglekar, one student of Benjamin Lee. Okay, so he first showed that the standard model can be built in S matrix, which I have that reference there, like from the unit vector S matrix. That's the first example I know that who actually consolidated a standard model in a good unitarity viewpoint. Before that, there were like smaller works, like one I mentioned here.
Sorry, what year was that? You said
1970, like 71 or 72.
So the model was already proposed.
Yes, model was. So it was like looking back,
yeah.
Always. it's true, like we have not we're not proposing a model with unitarity, but if you propose a model, you can always go back and check, is that model is good enough? Mm-hmm. So it's a good checkpoint because it gives us the correct result. So no, in that sense, unitarity did not give us a new theory, just mm-hmm. to check, but it's a nice check to me. So standard model was not before this unitarity.
I think now going back is not required anymore, no? Because I think it is proved. But any gauge theory has to be unitary. So.
Has to be unitary, right.
So.
But if, even if you see people look for effective field theory, so you can do a bottom-up approach. So you need something like neutrino mass, then you can actually see, like here from this simple argument, you can actually see what possible alternatives you can have. And it readily gives you the, one could think about something like this, that I can also draw a diagram. Say E minus E minus to a say doubly charged vector boson.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. To cancel this. Now, you know you cannot achieve seesaw with doubly charged vector boson. And unitarity gives a like stupendously simple answer why you cannot do that. Because this contains an extra momentum factor here, this will give you energy growth one order higher than this one. So you cannot cancel the energy growth of this one with this one. That's why there is no seesaw with double charge vector ocean. I mean, you can try, but you will fail to construct a model. And this is a reason why you will fail to construct a model with gauge boson. So yeah, this kind of simple arguments you can draw. I mean, without this is the bottom line approach. So anyway, yeah, it might be trivial, but I think it's useful. That's all.
Other questions? Now's your chance.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I mean, this, I guess I'm missing this answer, but what happens if I try to play the same game with gravity, for example?
I have no idea.
Okay. Because that's, that's kind of the same problem, right?
Yes. I can refer to a work who actually I went up to unitarizing WW to WW scattering with spin 1 boson. There is one work who tried to unitarize WW to WW scattering with spin 2 boson. Okay, you can look at that, probably the answer is there. And they said that it is possible to unitarize WW to WW scattering using a spin 2 boson if these some the fields obey BRST symmetry and etc., which I have no idea about. But there is a paper, I can show you there.
I think this has something to do with looping quantum gravity. You have to add in particles and...
Anyway, that's beyond me, Sorry, yeah, that's no comment about
it. This effective theory of this coupling that has units, then it's kind of the same idea in gravity, right?
Yeah, probably one can change.
This coupling
yes, in gravity you had another problem that you cannot write it as a tangent theory, which is additional problem. In that case, you need to move into the Cartesian.
Even in linear gravity, I mean something like that.
Well, linearized gravity is a cheaper trick, but in principle, you need to do it in a. The thing that you want to do is to put it in the Jang-Mills way properly.
No.
I should not comment anything. Sorry. I have no idea.
Other questions or comments?
Okay, well, I have another one. So, so let's suppose now we discover a new particle, let's say with a 750 GeV mass. Mm. That's a number we came up with.
Actually, there is a paper, what you try to imply if that is a scalar.
Really? There is?
Yes, I can show you just.
Okay, that was basically the question, whether one can use the same argument.
Yes, you can. From H to gamma gamma, you can extract away the coupling, so what will be the coupling? Then, what energy you will expect new physics, like additional physics to appear, you can get from neutrality. So you assume 750 GeV to be a scalar, you see how strongly it needs to couple with the gauge boson, then you consider your favorite process. So with that coupling, you try to unitarize that, and that will grow with energy, and you make it less than 1, and you see this is the value of energy before which new physics must set in. So there's a paper.
Okay.
That.
Do you remember that value of energy?
No, I can show you the paper.
But I guess that must assume something, right? Because
yeah, I mean,
this guy is a singlet that doesn't couple to the standard model of gauge bosons.
Yes, it might happen. And then you cannot have any information from unitarity. But they consider possible scenarios where you can have.
Okay.
Like, I had one stupid paper like this when people were talking about this enhancement of mu to gamma gamma, H to gamma gamma, and when there was a substantial enhancement, say it is twice the thing. People were doing, okay, since the top quark and the W boson interfere destructively, so we get a lower value of mu gamma gamma. Yeah. What happens if the top quark Yukawa is opposite to that of
the sign, no?
And then you make a constructive interference, then you can do it. But the thing is, the top quark Yukawa sign is governed by this process like this, E plus E minus to W plus W minus. You remove here by Higgs, and you see this is GEEH times GWWH. There is no square. So it determines your top quark Yukawa coupling. So you flip the Yukawa coupling, you actually do not cancel the growth here. So if you do not cancel the growth here, then you will have a, like Fermi theory, you will have an effective scale. And that scale was pretty low, 5 TeV. So my conclusion was, do not play this game, this is dangerous. So I wrote a paper about that, it was stupid, but anyway.
One long time ago, I was in a lecture talk of Bali, you know that. And he was speaking the same problem, I think, about this utilitarian and not Higgs kind of extension. And he was telling that that if you put like classical configurations of the fields in the loops, that they may appear at very high energies, like producing macroscopic configurations, then you can solve the geometric problem.
In principle, the inequality principle says that you consider energy beyond all the particles in your theory. So you can get information using unitarity when you specify your particle content and go to an energy which is beyond all the particle energies, like you ignore all your particles' masses. So
this idea was not including new particles, but saying, okay, maybe a classical big macroscopic configuration with very high energy.
Okay, and I mean, I must confess that I don't know about that, but maybe that is different, but I have no...
I also have no idea about that, I'm just telling you.
Yeah, might be that interesting to look at.